Hey, what's going on, residents of Meepletown? Today we're gonna be playing Egizia, Shifting Sands. Now in this game, Pharaoh wants to be remembered, so he's gathering his best builders, us, sending us down the Nile to build monuments. And whoever builds the monuments the best will score the most victory points. So I say, let's get this thing to the table. Let's check out Egizia, Shifting Sands by Stronghold Games. All right, residents of Meepletown, we have Egizia Shifting Sands set up and we are ready to play. Now, I do want to point out this is the two-player side of the board, so this is a little bit different than the higher player counts. There are two spots here that are gone. Also, something a little bit different. These are slightly different too, like the pyramid and the obelisk. But we're going to be placing a purple on this gold spot or yellow spot right here. It says in a two-player game to place this G6 spot here and a purple one here. If you don't know what that means, you'll get it here in just a second. And so in Egizia, basically this is a worker placement game, y'all. We're going to be placing our ships on either these spots on the cards or here in these three different places to be building in the pyramids or the colonnade or these different things here. Now, whenever we place our ships, we always have to place downstream from a previously placed ship. So you're going to have that pull and tug of, do I want to, you know, skip down here because I really want this spot, but then I'm opening up the opportunity for my opponent or opponents to get several spots as we progress down the Nile. So I'm going to just dive right in here, y'all, and we're going to begin playing this. So I'm going to be playing as yellow. And yellow is the first player. Now, yellow gets two bricks to start off with because they're first player. Blue is going to have three. She's going to have three bricks to start off with. So I'm simply going to take my ship and I'm going to place it starting at the top of the Nile on one of these card spots, one of these worker placement spots, or again, on these three different things where I'm actually building. And those are going to be how I'm going to score victory points. So I think the very first thing I'm going to do is just go to this card, because what I'm going to be doing is wanting to increase my stone production. There's only two resources in this entire game. It's wheat to feed your workers, or grain to feed your workers, and stone to be able to build in all this. So I think right off the bat, let's go ahead and let's start building a little bit of a stone engine. Now, she's kind of thinking something really similar. Now, going to this spot is pretty interesting. This is where the pool goes, because right here, this is going to actually increase our leader and their ability, their strength, and I'll talk about that here in a second. Also allow us to shift this irrigation ring. But over here, it says during the feeding phase, she'll be able to produce two grain if it's yellow and one stone. That's really tempting early in the game. But she could just jump down here thinking that she might want to take this, though the challenge becomes if I jump down and take this, now she's not getting any stone production. So what she's going to do is, I think she's going to take the risk and just say, you know what, she wants to build here. She's going to hope that she can get this tile later, but she's going to place it in a two-player game. This is the only spot. In a higher player count, there's actually enough spots for the number of players minus one. So if it was a three-player game, there would be two spots here. So she is the only one now in this round that can go to one of these two spots, pretty much, with the exception of if I get this spot down here. So now that it's my turn again, this is intriguing. So I've placed only up here so I could increase my leader. What I'm worried about is if she gets too far down, she could start taking more of these spots. But she also doesn't have enough stone right now to really do a lot of production in these different spots. This card is tempting because it says, you know, produce six grain. So if the irrigation ring is up to this red spot here, which is red, then I'm going to be able to produce six grain, which is a lot of grain. But if she's keeping it down, not in the red here, then I produce nothing. Now, I do immediately also get to move up in this grain area here. I think I'm going to take that, actually. I think I'm going to, let's see here. Or should I come down? Should I think about this? Okay, one more thing I'm going to point out at this point in time in the game is we did start off with a Sphinx card. And so my goal here to score 6 points at the end of the game is be all the way up in this market and have at least four bricks built in the pyramid. And that would give me 6 points at the end of the game. We can get more of these cards. She has complete the colonnade and have at least three bricks in the obelisk. And that is why she really wanted to start here. I'm thinking more along down here and not so worried about this at the moment. So I'm actually, let's see what she does. I think I'm actually going to, I'm going to take this card right here. I'm going to just kind of slow play it. That's going to increase, give me yet another stone, and also if it's on the yellow in the middle, I'm going to get 2 grain. Now, she is fairly happy about that because she wanted to make sure she got one of these. She kind of hates passing up on this to increase her crew level because she needs to increase the crew level to be able to build here more. But she's nervous that I'm going to take that, take this next. So she's going to go ahead and grab this. So now that she can have 6 production when it comes to the stone. Now, I'm not so worried about the grain right now. I'm going to go ahead and go to this spot. This immediately lets me increase 2 levels on my crew. And you will see during the building phase what the crew, how the crew levels work. I'm going to go ahead and increase my leader 1. And then I'm going to increase, that doesn't really matter, this green crew member 1. I can also move this. And right now, you have to match during the feed phase, which I'll show you all. You have to match the colors with your fields here. So right now we both have a green field and I have a yellow field. So I want to keep this high. I'm actually going to shift it up 1. Even though there's an arrow pointing up 1, you can actually go up or down. I'm going to shift it up here. That way we can hopefully at least keep it in the yellow so I can count that during the feeding phase. And again, you'll see that here in a second. So now that it's her turn, I was really tempted to get this. And I was sort of tempted to get this. Let's see, does she want to go ahead and grab that so that she could maybe work on this down here? I think she's going to. I think she's going to take this spot. You'll see what that is here in a second, that she may potentially be able to get one of these. Now, I really want this spot, so I'm going to go ahead and take this, even though I'm skipping taking that right there, because I want to be able to build in the pyramid and start building on my statues, hopefully. Her next move is, let's see here, what does she want to do? She want to go ahead and get some more grain. She could also attach, she could attach this as a permanent to upgrade a card, basically. But she doesn't need to upgrade any cards because right now there's green and green, and green is on all 3 of these when it comes to the irrigation. So that's really not that interesting for her. I think she's going to jump down here. And oh, if she does that though, then she's leaving me open to grab this. And she's worried that I'm going to come all the way, but she does not, she can't jump all the way down here at this point, I don't think. Because if she doesn't, she's not increased her crew strength very much. Ooh, that's a really tough decision for her to really hope that I don't take this. She's going to just hope that I don't take it. And this is going to allow her to go up once in both of these markets. I'm sorry, she's blue. She's going to go up in that market, in this market, and we'll talk about what these do here in just a little bit. Then it's going to be my turn here, and wow, I am really tempted to come down here and increase my crew strength again, but I'm also going to have to feed my workers based on that. And so that's one thing that she noticed is that I've got 3. This one's worth 3. This one's worth 2. Those are both worth 1, so that's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And right now I can produce 8 if this ring stays here or here, which is great. But if I increase my crew members 2, then I actually don't have the food to be able to pay for these workers. So that kind of puts me in a little bit of a pickle, actually, because of that. I think I'm actually going to assume she's going here. I'm going to go all the way down here and just continue to build that stone engine so that I can have a big stone engine in this game. And she's going to have a little bit of a pull because she would not mind going to the Sphinx area, but she's going to be able to do it anyways. I'll show you why here in a second. She is going to go here, which is perfect for her to increase, and she's going to also increase her leader, and she's going to increase the green. All right, and now she can move this ring, and she's going to move it down 1 here just because she has green, and she's hoping that she's not going to be able to do it at this round, but maybe later on she could eliminate or not allow me to get that 2 right there. Now that it's my turn again, I'm going to take that last spot here on the Sphinx. Now what she's going to do for her last turn is, you may say, well, there's not any spots there. There is. You can speculate. And what speculating does is if I decide not to use this or to build this, her ship, she can actually do it. Now what's interesting is this spot right here allows her to take a ship that is speculating and go ahead and do the action, but she goes second. So this is a really important spot in this game, a hugely important spot. So now that all those have been done, we're going to enter into the stone, the quarry phase here. And so we're going to increase our stone based on our numbers here. So I've got 6, 7, 8. So I'm going to go 2 plus 8. That's 10. I've got 10 stone over here. Excuse me, plus this one. I almost missed that. That's why I like to put it in between. That's actually 11 stone that I'm at now. She has 6 stone. So she's going to go from 3 up to 9. And then after we do the stone phase, we're going to feed our workers. And as I was showing you earlier, we're going to add all these numbers up. So 3 for this worker, 2 for this, that's 5, 6, 7. And we both have the exact same. We both need to feed 7. And one of the negative for her, I didn't even, I wasn't even thinking about that for her. Yikes. That really hurts. That actually hurts her a little bit. Yep, well, trying to play two players. That's right. She's okay with losing a couple points. Okay, so she actually has 6 grain, which means, and again, you're going to look at this green, it's on the green. So she actually can't feed one of her one strength worth. Again, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which now we're going to look up here, and wherever you're at in this market means she's going to lose, because she at least went up one here. She's in this section. She's going to lose 2 victory points, and you can go negative in this game. So she's going to lose 2 victory points for having that one missing grain. I, on the other hand, have 7, but I can feed 8 because I'm on the yellow and green section, which is what I have. So I am doing A-okay. Now we can move into the building phase. And she is the only one that can build in either one of these spots, and she can build in both if she wants, but the way this works is you're going to always spend stone to build on any of these areas on this side of the board. So during the building phase, really grain is for feeding your workers, and the only other resource is stone, and that does everything. And so what you'll have to do is you have to not only have the stone, like in the obelisk, 2 stone, 2 stone, 3 stone, you go from the bottom up, or in the colonnade, 1, 2, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, and you go from left to right in the colonnade. Not only do you have to have the stone to do it, the resources, you also have to have the crew strength. And you can only send out one crew per section, with the caveat that your leader goes with one of your crew members. And so your leader cannot be spent 3 strength without spending another crew member. And so she is really wanting to build up in here most. So she is going to spend her green crew member to do it, which is worth 2. And then she's going to also spend her leader. Now, no other time or other place, unless you have a leader, can you spend 2 crew at one time. So when she gets down here, she's only going to have 1 crew strength to do. She will not be able to add those together. All right, so with that being said, she knows that she has 2 really important goals. She wants to build 3 in here. She also wants to complete this entirely. And she has 9, which is really nice. So the first thing she's going to do is she's going to go ahead and build, let's see, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah. She's going to actually go ahead and build 3 sections of this, because she has once. Ooh, does she? She is. She's not going to do it. So instead of building in the obelisk this turn, because she has 5 points worth, she's going to build on these 3 spots. And the reason is she wants to have this increase your crew strength 1 point bonus per round. And she actually is going to take this eye right here, and that's going to indicate if she's used it during the round, she's going to flip it over to that side. If you get the other one, you'll put 1 on the left and 1 on the right. Now, this is only in a 2-player game. Every other game, this is a yellow one, and you would only have 1 eye. But you would put 1 on the other side to indicate which one's on the left and which one's on the right. So she spends 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. She does wastes kind of one of her crew strengths, because there isn't anything for her to build on 1 there. But again, she wanted to jump out and grab that so she could go ahead and just boom. Like even right now, she's going to flip that over and she's going to increase her crew strength 1, which is going to help her down here. So that's not a bad move at all, really. Then we're going to come down here and we're going to look at this next section. Now it's my turn. I've got a decent amount of stone here, but I also don't have huge crew strength. I'm going to do the same thing that she did and go ahead and flip over 2 of those. So now I can spend 5. And if you remember that this card right here, I'm trying to build at least 4 in the pyramid. And I'm also trying to get to the top of this one. Which I didn't do that at all, but I can get there. So the way that, I forgot to mention, I'm sorry, now that she spent 4 stone, she gets 4 victory points. 1, 2, 3, 4. So she's actually already paid back some of those ones that she had. So when you're spending stone and this down here, and for the most part down here, you're going to score victory points. Here's a little different. This is going to be in-game scoring. And what this says, if I want to build on my statue, is I can only build on a single statue 1 time in a given round. So I could build on both of these in this first round, but I couldn't build two layers on one or the other. And this means if I get a brick here, at the end of the game, if I have 3+ bricks in the pyramid, I'll score 2 points. If I build up to this section, if I have 4 bricks here, I'd score. So this is actually going to work really well with this card that I have. So what I want to do is I want to spend 5. I'm going to build right here. And I do not score a victory point for doing this. I'm going to build right there. This is going to say that based on my crew strength, wherever this gets up to, I score victory points at the end of the game. I think I'm going to hold off for just a minute on there. Then I'm going to build 2 in this pyramid because I have 5 strength. So let me go ahead and spin my 1. On the pyramid, you start on the bottom. And you go work your way to the left. Now, after you've built 2 on the bottom, I could build right here. So if the bottom ones are actually completed, then the one on top of it, you can build there. What's interesting about this is, let me go ahead and give myself 4 points, is that when you get to the end of a row, whoever has the most bricks or most stone in that gets that victory points for the number of stone that they have there. Same thing for there, same thing for there. Also, at the end of the game, whoever has the most bricks in the pyramid scores 5 victory points. So there is my, so I need to spend another 4. So I'll go down to 6. And that's all that I can do. I was able to use all 5, which is pretty solid, not bad at all. Now we're going to come down here to the Sphinx. And since I'm right in this spot, I get to go first. And what I do here is I spend a crew, so I can only spend 1. And what I'm going to do is just draw 1 card. So it really stinks that I don't even have an option right now, except for I'm going to draw a card. I'm going to spend 1 stone. And this says if you, I get 5 victory points at the end of the game if I've completed the colonnade. So what I can do at this point is I can either return this and score 1 victory point for every card I return, or I can keep it. And at this point, you know, 1 victory point's not a lot. Let me just go ahead and maybe I'll get this colonnade completed. I'm going to take that card, but I don't score any victory points. Now that she is in speculating, she can go and she can use this action right here to actually now do this. Now what she can do is she's going to spend 2 of her strength right here, and that is going to cost her 2 brick, 1, 2, and she's going to draw 2 cards. Now she can only keep 1 of these. You can max out on 5 of these, so if she had 5 strength, she could draw 5. She's only going to keep 1, but every time she returns 1, and every single one costs a stone, she gets a victory point. So that's not bad at all. So she's going to say, this one says if your blue pure member strength is 5+, she gets 3 points. Well, she's already got on 2. That's pretty easy, but it's not a lot of points. 4 points if all of her crews have a strength of at least 3. She's going to say, you know what? She has a pretty high value one right here. She's going to say, let's just take a sure thing and grab that so that I can get that at the end of the game. She paid her 2 stone, kept 1, so she will score 1 victory point for the 1 card that she just returned there. So that is the end of the round. Just a couple other things I'm going to point out. What's going to happen next round is we actually have these tiles and these are going to shuffle. And so this is actually going to change, which I think is really interesting. So you're not having the same exact order of those spots that you're doing. We're also going to remove all of these cards and replace it with new cards. That's how we're going to keep up with what round it is. There will be 5 rounds. And of course, this is a victory point game. So whoever has the most victory points at the end of the game wins. A couple more real quick things. This track is going to allow us, we're going to just get stoned for hitting these sections. Also, at the end of the game, if we get into this or this section, we will score 1 victory point per 2 stone that we have left at the end of the game. Up here, this not only has to do with how many, if you're missing grain, losing victory points, but also at the top here, whenever you do the feeding phase, you can trade. If you have excess of 3 grain, or for every 3 grain that you have an excess of, you can score a victory point. So if I had 6 extra grain, I would score 2 victory points. Also, at the top of this, anytime I need to, I have the option to go up in this track, and I can't because I'm on the top, I score 2 victory points. Down here, every time I get to the top of this and need to, and I can go up on this track, I get 3 stone. So this is another way to build a stone engine. So I say, let's go ahead and let's talk about the art and components of this game. All right, so when it comes to the art and components, I really like the box art. I kind of showed that earlier. I'm going to kind of show this to you all right there. All right, so there's the box art. I think it's really pretty solid. The rest of it is okay. I'm not blown away by it. I don't know what to say. I think it's really a personal taste thing. It kind of gives me some, I don't know what it is. Like, it's almost like a computer graphic kind of looking thing to me, like a kind of older school 90s computer. I don't know what it is, but it doesn't super appeal to me. I also don't think it's bad. It's just not super my personal taste. course, this is completely objective. You may absolutely love it. I think it's fine. Doesn't blow my mind, but not bad. I do like, component-wise, the ships quite a bit. These are just, you know, some stones, wooden pieces of stone. That's not bad. These, all the other cardboard pieces are adequate. They're fine. They don't blow my mind, but they're definitely better than just having cardboard pieces for these. So I really do like that quite a bit. So that's the art and components. Now let's talk about gameplay. All right, so let's talk about gameplay. Let's start with the things I really like about Egizia Shifting Sands. First of all, the way that the worker placement works is pretty neat in this game. So it's not just that you're going to worker placement spots, hoping your opponent doesn't go there next round or opponents, and then you get that spot. If you go too far down the Nile, you cannot go back and get those spots. Now, there's a way with the colonnade to be able to do that one time in a round and some things like that. But for the most part, when you decide to drop down, you're not going back. And so I think that's a really intriguing twist on worker placement. And I think that that leads to a lot of really grueling decisions. If you watch the gameplay, you saw that there were those moments where I'm like, ugh, I want to jump all the way down here because I want that spot super bad, but then I'm leaving my opponent the opportunity to pick up several spots. What is she going to do? What is he going to do? Trying to get in your opponent's head, really, and figure out where they're going to go next. There's a lot of that in this game because you're probably not going to jump super far down, and so you're like, all right, here's a few spots. Where are they going? What am I going to be able to get? And I think that's really actually quite a bit of fun in this game. I also really like the way that the stone, so you really have one resource to build with, is stone in this game. It's really simple. You're going to have one resource, grain, to feed your workers. And then you have the way your crew members work and your leaders, which I think the way all of those intertwine is pretty nice, pretty fun in this game, because you want to increase your crew so that you can spend more stone. But if you do that, you better make sure that you have the grain to feed those, or you're going to end up getting hosed and losing victory points. So it's just really fairly simple, very easy to understand, but yet leads to those kind of pulling decisions, and I like that about the game. So some things that I'm, some negatives or might be negative for you about the games would be, this game is pretty intense. Like the way that the worker placement works, it can be, like I said, those can be some grueling decisions. It can be really kind of intense, and I play with my wife. I've played with her the most I've played this game with is my wife, and she doesn't like games. She's really careful about games that are mean, and I think she kind of feels like there's a little bit of meanness here, because I can go and you're not trying to be mean though. I disagree with her to be real, because you're just trying to go for those spots. But with that, in conjunction with the irrigation ring, and the irrigation ring is personally probably my least favorite part of the game, because the whole point of that is to really hose other players, right? Depending on where the irrigation ring is where is the amount of grain you're going to be able to get in the game. And so if I have, you know, just green and yellow, but my opponent's got red, which is the very highest ring, then the only reason for me to lower it off red is just to hose her. Really, it's not going to give me any benefit besides hosing that opponent. So if you don't mind games where you can, where there's, you're just going to be mean, when you can be mean in that situation right there, then you might actually really like this. Like if you like that element, yeah, that's great. I want to be able to hose my other player. If they can try to do that to me, let's battle it back and forth on the irrigation ring. You might actually really like that. For me personally, I'm not a big fan of games that's aren't really mean, but there's kind of like one little kind of mean element kind of thrown into the game. If it's really like, you know, if you're playing Blood Rage or something, you're just going at it, that's fine. I'm good with that. But I didn't love that part of the game. That in conjunction with the way the worker placements, my wife was not a huge fan of this game, but I disagree with her though. Besides those, you know, couple fairly minor pieces, I think this is a fun game. I really do. The decisions you're making are great. There's a lot of ways to score victory points. The Sphinx cards are interesting to see, you know, what you might draw and give you some kind of targets to hit and try to make sure that your Sphinx cards are working with your obelisk and the colonnade and all that stuff coming together. Let me just kind of give you my final thoughts. With the way that the game plays out, the different ways to score victory points, the tenseness, I like tense games. The tenseness in going down the Nile, I think that that's really fun.
Again, the variety of ways to score victory points and trying to kind of intertwine them and make them work together. And the simplicity, actually, the simplicity is kind of interesting. Like, this is, to me, a Gateway Plus game. Like, it's not that hard to teach people because of how, you know, few resources there really are in this game. It's not that hard to wrap your mind around the way this game is. So I can see myself bringing this out with people who don't play, you know, medium or medium heavy games, which they may be more on the medium light end. I really think that this is fairly easy to wrap your mind around. It gives some interesting decisions. Again, if you really don't like tense games, if you don't like games that can be kind of mean, especially with that irrigation ring, then I don't think you may not like this game. But so overall, I like it. I'm going to give this a 7.5 out of 10. And that's a low 7.5. So let me say that. I was really wrestling between a 7 and a 7.5. So 7 means that I'm usually willing to play. I'm usually willing to play this game. And 8 would mean I'm going to suggest it. There's just a lot of other games out there I'd rather play than this. I think this is a very solid game. I think there are going to be people, and I know, that think that just absolutely love this game. I'm one of those ones that's kind of the middle. I think it's a good game. It's a solid game. Someone wants to play it. I'm going to be usually willing to play it. I'm probably not going to be doing much suggesting of the game. I might suggest it in those situations, or I will suggest it in the situations where I'm kind of in that Gateway Plus range. Like, this is one I would suggest for, like, or those medium light players, or those people who kind of borderline into medium, but don't want to get any heavier, you know, than that at all. This is one that I would bring out. Now, that's with the caveat that if people don't really like things that are intense or that could be kind of mean, if I'm worried about that, then this is, again, that's I'm not going to pull this out for that reason. But I do like the game, so I give this thing a 7.5, a low 7.5 if I can do that, out of 10. If you're enjoying our channel, we would love for you to subscribe to it. You can go to MeepleTownGames.com to check out all of our stuff. We're at MeepleTown Games on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And we're Board Game Geek Guild 3407. Thanks for coming down to MeepleTown.
Thanks for joining us. And be sure to follow us on Twitter at MeepleTown Games. And connect with us on the MeepleTown Guild, Guild number 3407, at BoardGameGeek.com. And also subscribe to our podcast and YouTube channel. And until next time, thanks for coming down to MeepleTown.